השלישי, אדם גדול, עקשן כילד, איש פשוט ואוהב, תמים, ותמימותו היא מכל כוחו. אלה הם כמה מן ההגדרות שהוצמדו בידי אנשים שונים לאנדרי סחרוב. ממפתחי הנשק הגרעיני בברית המועצות, שלחם, זה הפרדוקס של אישיותו, לפירוקו. סחרוב מת. תמונותיו האחרונות שהוצגו בטלוויזיה בעולם כולו, הראו אותו בוויכוח, כביכול נוהלי, עם גורבצ'וב עצמו, שקטע אותו בפומבי באמצע דבריו בחוסר סבלנות, ולא בפעם הראשונה, זה היה לפני לילות מעטים, וכולנו ראינו את הקטע הזה. האורחת האחרונה שלנו הערב הייתה ידידה קרובה, גם במוסקבה וגם בגלות, עידה נודל. בשנותיה האחרונות בברית המועצות הייתה היא בגלות בסיביר, והוא בגלות בעיירה גורקי. ובכל זאת, הקשר נשמר באורח כמעט יומיומי. ערב טוב, עידה נודל.
ערב טוב.
את ביקשת לא לעשות את הרעיון הזה בעברית.
כן.
אז לפני שנעבור לאנגלית, מדוע?
אני חושבת שזה נורמלי לאישה בגיל שלי, אחרי שנתיים בארץ, לדבר בעברית מטלוויזיה, זה לא אפשר.
עד עכשיו זה היה טוב מאוד מבחינת העברית, אבל אנחנו נמלא את בקשתך ונעבור לאנגלית. I would like you, first of all, if you could outline Sakharov for us. What a profile of a man could you draw?
I think that I would not be, nobody will tell that I am very subjective telling you that he was really a great man, a great human being. I met him when he was in his 50s, in the beginning of 70s, when I became to be active for behalf of my people, Jewish people. And because of my special interest of prisoners and human rights, we were a lot of times in contact, dealing over some cases. I gave him information and we discussed, and he, by his authority, supported me when I applied to Soviet government and I needed to send information abroad or publish in a chronic underground magazine. So it happened quite a lot of time when we were together.
Now, to coming back to his personality, would you describe him as what? As a leader? As a guru? As a sort of a spiritual father?
It is difficult to tell. He was a highly respected person, highly respected. Because he was sincere, he was very wise, very clever, very honest, and despite all his being academician and being a leading figure, no arrogance. When he spoke with you, you are a simple person, a worker, or just human being, and you apply to him. Doesn't matter if your Russian is not literacy, if you speak a simple language. He respects you. You feel from how he put questions, how he listened to you. He was really a great person.
He was described as a very simple person and very loving. So that is, he loved people.
Yes, he loved people, but I could not say that he was a simple person. No, of course not. If
well, naive was one of the epithets.
Naive, no, he wasn't naive. He was idealist, he was a dreamer. But dreamer and naivety not all the time, it is not the same quality. He was dreamer, he wanted to be his people, Russian people. He was best son of Russian people. He want his people to be civilized, to behave as all civilized world. And he put at stake his life, his freedom, his even his life, to do what he can to help his people to look civilized.
One of the most exciting thing for an observer from outside during his later years, last 20 or so years, was how they couldn't, as it were, shut his mouth. Although apparently they did almost anything in the book or outside the book of the KGB and others. How do you explain this? It's very rare.
Yes, it's really very rare. How they tortured him, how they ostracized him, how they organized all over the country a campaign against him and published dirty words and dirty slander against him. He is this kind of person who is not giving up. He was sincere. He believed that he is right. And he's a very unusual personality.
Would you say that what actually happened with the leaders of the Soviet Russia going down to the KGB and other people, that they became hateful towards him? I mean, personally, hating his existence, as it were.
I don't know how it's leader, but KGB definitely.
KGB hated him personally.
Because once he was among, not KGB, but he was among elite. He belonged to this exclusive group of people who was elite. And suddenly he changed his mind. They became to be defender of human rights and spoke against them. And I remember one story when it was hunger strike by Eduard Kuznetsov, and when I almost don't know what to do, how to send information, and how to make Andrei Dmitrievich and the Elena Bonner, they applied to KGB to have a meeting with Eduard Kuznetsov, and they were refused, and so I was between them, between one of the chiefs of the Communist Party who was dealing with the Minister of Interior Affairs, and they were in Mordovia, Sakharov, they were in Mordovia trying to have a meeting. And I was in Moscow calling all the time one of the chiefs of the Communist Party who worked with Minister of Interior Affairs. And nothing happened. Sakharov came back, and I told Andrei Dmitrievich, it is your turn to speak with him, to speak with Albert Ivanov. And he called to him, and Albert Ivanov told him, I don't want to speak with renegade. It is very hard for a person with such a status, but he's...
You mentioned a minute ago his wife. And I would like to ask you, they as a couple struck a very dramatic picture in the West as well when she was very sick and she was allowed after his hunger strike to go to the West and come back and so on. What kind of a couple were they? Because you met them as a couple many times and you were at their house and so on.
They were really very lovely couple. With his very mild character and with his great love to her. And she is very strong and very, very reserved and sometimes even cruel person in her words. Such a combination really working very good. And sitting with them many times in their kitchen, I noted a depth of his love to her. She was washing dishes and suddenly she made some not very stable move, and it looks like she's going to hit her head about corner, and he like lion jumped and put his hand between wall and between her head. It shows how deeply he was caring about her, how he loved her.
If I'm not mistaken, one of the first opportunities you had to cooperate with him was during a certain demonstration that you wanted to organize.
It wasn't the first. It was in
one of the first.
One of our contacts. It was in after a bus bringing Israeli children from Tel Aviv to Haifa was hijacked by Palestinians, and all children and teachers were killed. And I learned this information from Call of Israel in Russian language, and it was in the evening, and in the morning I went to Sakharov's because I thought we need to react, how we could keep silence in such a moment. I went to them, it was morning, Usually I never decorate myself, but this time I put on myself a big Magin David. And he opened the door and asked me, what happened? I told him all the story, and I told him that I think we need to make a demonstration to react on such a vandalism. And he told that, well, I'm going with you. And he shouted to his wife, Lucia, Lucia, come. She was in the sleeping room. Lucia came and retold her story, and she told, yeah, I'm going with you also. So we decided to, we discussed how to organize this demonstration. We thought a new one building, other building, third building, and he rejected all my suggestions. And after that, she brought to us a book of official organizations in Moscow. And he began to select what. And it happened that in this book, it was written that the United Nations has a headquarter of human rights, something like it. And I went down, took a taxi, ran to this place to see if it possible to make a demonstration in this area. And I found out no such a headquarter. I came back, we discussed it. He gave a new suggestion. I went down, took a taxi, ran to a new place to see if it possible to make a demonstration of 20, 30 people. I don't know how many we will collect. And it happened 3 or 4 times. At last, we decided we will go to this house of international friendship. It is there were possible
and,
to
and
make.
And that was the in the center of town.
Yes, it was in the center of town, and it was very difficult for me. Was a very difficult moment. I lost control and I don't know what to do next time. More than almost 30 people standing, we are keeping silence because lack of time, we had no slogans, nothing. We are organizing a half a day. And I don't know what to do. And suddenly he began to speak loudly, slowly and loudly, to retell the story what happened in Israel. And people stopped, listened, and some of them asked questions, but they ran out of us, they were scared.
Scared of the what, the KGB?
Scared of all this situation, unusual for Soviet people, open a public demonstration.
After the demonstration, did he say anything to you about?
Yes, after demonstration, he told me that Ida, I believe that Israel would not punish a Palestinian people. I told him I have no power. Next day or 2 days after, Israeli Air Force bombarded camps, refugee camps. And he asked, I had no telephone, but he asked from some people to call, ask me to call to him. I called and he told me, I'm very sorry that I participate in this demonstration because your government was very cruel.
You disagreed with him?
I don't agree. If somebody hit you, but you must defend yourself, not just telling him, I'm sorry you wrong.
But you were all concentrated in the Jewish question, whereas he was working for human rights to every person in the world.
Not in the world,
no,
but mostly in Soviet Union, yes.
Yes.
Yes, but a Jewish question was part of human rights issue.
Yes.
In Soviet Union.
Now, an interesting thing happened when both of you were, in fact, in exile. You in Siberia, and he was in that town, Gorky. And still you maintained somehow the connection. How?
Because I was exiled before. And I went through all these bad feelings of loneliness and being in a hostile environment, and I understand how it's important to have a contact with somebody who is very positive and who love you and who support you. I decided that it was almost after a year and a half I was exiled, so I came to my senses already in some way. I decided to make a contact with them. I send letters and no responses. I send registered letters, but I felt that signature wasn't his. So, to my
signature
on a return receipt.
Yes.
And to my mind, it came one crazy idea. I bought a tablecloth, very nice, put it inside a letter, made a parcel, and valued it 500 rubles. So it's such a great value. I paid money, and the post office has obligation to deliver it or to give me money back, because I registered yes. in this, and I paid money for that. So they gave them my parcel, and the same way they sent me a box of sweets, and they also valued it 100 rubles. It cost 3 rubles. So we organized.
And later on, you spoke to them on the phone.
Yes, and even I managed to send him vegetables. I grow vegetables
in Siberia.
Yes, in Siberia, and I sent
You received from them a certain photograph of them. Here it is, and on the back there was a sort of a message in writing. Now I'll give it to you to translate, if you could, for us, because it's in Russian, and it's from 1986.
Yes,
when you were in Siberia.
No, I wasn't in Siberia already. I was in Moldavia. In 86, I was in Moldavia. This picture was made in 85, after he was released from psychiatric prison, and she was after hunger strike. You could easily see from their faces how they exhausted, even physically, not only emotionally, and you could see from his eyes how he's, what a pain in his heart. On the opposite side, they wrote, "To dear Ida from us, August 5th, 86, postscriptum, it is we in October 85. Now we are more added in a weight, not in a social sense, but in the kilograms. Mm-hmm. Kisses, Lucia Andrei."
Yes. Now, to ask you a question which he might have been able to answer a week ago, but not now, so I ask you, would you think he was happy, or seeing what's happening now in the Soviet Union as a victory for his opinions and battles? The glasnost, the perestroika, what's happening now, say, in the Soviet bloc, as it was until about a week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks ago?
I don't think that he was very happy, but he was proud that he paid and played a great role in what is happening now. And as a statesman, he understands that it is a crucial time for his country, for his people. And he tried to do everything possible, and he paid dearly. He lost his life. I think that not only he and his wife played a great role, but a lot of people who were around him, and his name and his involvement kept them free, and in many times kept them alive. All these efforts together brought a great fruit. And I mean, Eastern Europe. We don't know what will happen in Soviet Union, how it will be developed, but definitely they are giving up Eastern Europe and maybe even Baltic republics. And it is a great achievement. And this man, it is his achievement.
Ida Nudel, thank you very much indeed.